Hello, this is Angela Anderson. Thanks for joining me today. This project today that we're doing is part of a live summer art camp here on YouTube. I'm teaching all week long live shows at 12 noon Central on this very channel. So this is day three, and we're doing a peacock feather Zentangle watercolor. We're going to use Sharpie markers to fill in our designs, and then we're going to color them in with watercolors. If you don't have watercolor paper, you can do this project on regular paper and just not use the watercolors because watercolors will make the regular paper buckle and tear. But it's totally doable with colored pencils. It's a lot of fun. I've done this with my kids' project. You can see up there in the upper corner one of the projects that one of my students did with this. She did a really good job. And this was my example. I didn't get very far coloring it, so what I'm going to do is show you how to draw it, and then I'll go back to this one to color since I've got a lot of the designs already drawn up on it. How are we doing? I have my son Spencer here today with
Hello,
me. Say
everybody.
hi, Spencer.
We have 8 people watching now for the
Awesome.
art. Says hello.
Oh, Janine, thanks for joining me again today. That's great. Yeah, we started out slow with all of these. We'll pick up more people as we go along, for sure. So I've got my colored pencils. I've got some watercolor pencils. If you don't have watercolor pencils, you can grab a little watercolor set. And if you have colored Sharpies, you can use those too. Any number of different ways of doing this project. That's why I love these Zentangle projects. They're really fun. So what I did with my kids' class is I don't start out with any of the colors out. I just start out with a plain piece of paper and a pencil for them. That way we don't get into the Sharpies or do anything that we're not ready for yet. I have them trace out on regular plain paper their drawing first before they go onto the real expensive heavy-duty watercolor paper. I used this Strathmore watercolor paper in my class with them. Of course, we did it on bigger sheets. It comes in all different sizes, but I find that this let's see, it's 140-pound cold press paper works really well. If you don't have that, you could use this water media. It also works well. It's a little bit less water resistant than the actual watercolor paper, so just keep that in mind. So let me find a clean. Oh, there's my cardinals. There's my pear blossoms. There's my Maleficent. The nest. Let's find clean. There's my sunset dock that I did last week. Oh, this is preview. Don't tell anybody. There's my dragonfly. That is coming out on Saturday. And there's my ice cream cone from yesterday, or the day Monday. And then this was the tree yesterday that we painted. All right, here we go. And I've got, well, I'll get to those later. I'm gonna set those aside. Okay, so to do our peacock feather, I'm gonna go ahead and do mine on my regular paper and not on my practice paper. Oh, got my pen. The reason I'm using Sharpies, and I know that they're permanent, but because they're permanent, you can paint over them and they won't smear. If you used regular markers with this, they would smear. Now, if you're going to do it with colored pencils, use any kind of marker you want on paper and just color pencil over them, they'll be just fine. But if you're going to add water to it, I would grab a permanent marker like a Sharpie or Pitt markers or something like that. But the Sharpies are really cheap and they're great for kids' projects. You don't want to use up your good markers with your kids because they will be pretty hard on them.
That's
Yeah, to say the least. Okay, so I want my peacock feather head to be nice and big. And so I'm going to put it right up in this upper corner here and I'm going to point it out that way. So I'm going to draw a big teardrop shape, and I'm not going to connect the bottom quite yet. Once I get that in there, let me go ahead and use Sharpie. Boy, this is a test, right? This is scary.
We are,
better not make a mistake.
We're joined by Cinnamon in the chat.
Hey, Cinnamon! Yay, I'm glad you could join me today.
She says, great nails, Angela.
Oh, isn't that fun? Those are my Pantone Color of the Year nails. I pulled that color out again. Okay, so I'm going to go right up underneath this opening here that I left, and I'm going to do a squiggly line. Not too squiggly. I just want it to kind of snake along lazily. I'm going to do another line right next to it. Get it as close as you can. This is going to be the stem of our feather. All right, now that I've got that, I'm going to do a little curved line there and there to join that up, and then I'm just going to cut that off right there because we want this to be a different color than this, probably. All right, now I'm going to do my second lines, and I'm going to, let's go ahead and start here. I'm going to do a little V shape right here, and then I'm going to go real close and just try to kind of stay about the same distance away from your first line and go all the way around on the inside of that, like that. Now we're going to do our green shape, and then this, in my picture, I kind of did it in a cone shape, then I actually pulled out my actual feather, and I was like, this part is really kind of more like an oval, isn't it? It's not like pointed right here, so I'm going to do it that way. I'm going to do it and cut off this end. I'm just going to do a big fat oval right here, like that. And if your starting and stopping points show, you can kind of just try to smooth them out a little bit. And I like to use the large Sharpie to do my outlining. And that way, when I go to do my details, I can use my smaller Sharpie. And they won't be too bold. But it's good to have these really strong outlines. Okay, now this little section in here is like a upside down V. So I'm going to do a little mark like that. And then we're going to do another circle, a little bit smaller than that first one. Woo. Like that. I probably could have come out a little bit more on that. That's okay. Okay, so there's our center of our peacock. I'm going to curve off any sharp edges because I don't want it to be sharp. Okay, that's good. Like that. Now I'm going to start doing my squiggly lines out from my center of my feather. I'm going to start at the top. I'm just going to do a couple of lines. And this really doesn't matter. I just kind of want to mimic my waves and have them all kind of generally going in this upper direction, kind of facing and around the head of my peacock feather. Leave a big enough space so that you'll have plenty of room for all of your designs to go. And let me do one more here. Well, let's do this. Let's bring this one up and kind of close to this one, like that. See how we did that? Let's do this other side. One more, and then we'll do the same thing. We'll go in, out, back in. We're going to kind of follow that first, that line above it. And now we're going to keep filling up. I'm going to do some closer together and some really far apart. Some kind of in the middle. Just vary it up. How many patterns you want to make is how many spaces you're going to leave yourself here. And notice I'm doing all of my lines starting out angled up this way, and then I curve them back down. Just like that. Up, over. These ones are starting to kind of get do another one right up next to that one. So Spencer got his grades in yesterday.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah. And he has a B. Oh, Spencer.
I think it'll be fine. I tried my best. If my best was playing video games. And...
That's what I was going to say. Yeah, if your best was playing video games, you did your best, for sure.
Absolutely. Best every day.
Yeah, you do your best every day. With the game playing. Okay, so there we go. There's our peacock. I think I like it. I'm going to go ahead and switch over to my smaller Sharpie. This is where a little pre-planning can come into play if you want to for your kiddos. I've found that it's really helpful to have a little cheat sheet already set up. You can do this on your own, or you can find patterns off of the internet. There's lots of patterns that you can print out that are pre-drawn, and just print out a few of those, have them set around. They don't have to use these, but this just gives them a couple ideas, because sometimes they kind of get stumped and they don't know what to do. You may have to help them with some of them, so I wouldn't do really complicated ones unless you're using it this with older kids. So I'm going to set that aside. I'm just going to put my, oops, I still have my peacock thing up there. Let me turn that off. There we go. We can see some of our patterns here. Just going to do a few, and then I want to show you the coloring. I'm not going to fill in the whole thing today. What I might do with this project is to do this part first, like maybe day one, do the black and white Zentangle with them, because this can take quite a while to do. Of course, some kids are like in a race to finish, so they will like have this filled up. You'll like turn around and blink, and they'll like, it'll be boom, done. You're like, what the heck happened? And then some will be more like I was as a child, and will like take 3 hours on one little section and not be finished. So know your child. And if they're going to take a long time with it, I would say just go ahead and let the coloring part be for day two. And that way they have something to look forward to, and you can kind of stretch this out into a 2-day project with them. With this particular one, though, instead of like some of the other Zentangles that I've done, I've filled up every single one of my sections with a different pattern. But if you see with this one, the way I did it, I kind of did every other with a pattern, and I left a few blank ones, and that kind of just helps your eye breathe a little bit, if your eye could breathe. But I think it really kind of helps. But you can go as crazy as you want to and fill it up as much as you want. I just felt like with this particular one, I kind of liked the look of it having a little bit extra space between it. So sometimes I did like along the line designs instead of inside having a different one in each little section. There's all kinds of fun things that you can do with this.
Your eye breathing. I'm still getting, still trying to get over that.
Are you trying to picture that?
I really don't want to.
You don't want to?
I feel like I'm going to see something I don't want to. But
you feel like you're going to see something you don't want to. I like that. So one of the things that I would say is that if you're going to do a really heavy, heavy design that's got a lot of black in it, go ahead and switch back over to your black pen. I think I'm going to straighten this one out and see. I'll fix my little boo-boo here by making this like a big old square. And I'm going to do every other one in like a checkerboard. Well, not a checkerboard. These are like really fat squares. Right. So if you've got a big area to cover up, that's a great way of doing it. Just kind of pick a pattern that's solid and switch back to your large marker and fill those areas in. But what I was going to say was, do not put two black heavy designs next to each other, because they will cancel each other out and you won't see anything. You'll just have a big black old blob. If I did another set of designs in this one that had a lot of black in it, it would mush both of those lines together into a big black blob. So leave a space in between. If you're going to do another black heavy design, put it in a space over here. I would just leave this one blank completely, or maybe do a very light design in it. Like, none of my Sharpie small markers are working today. Like something like this that has a lot of space around it, and that you'll just be filling in with mostly color. So.
There's not much going on in chat right now. There's just a lot of catching
no?
up. Just a lot of hellos going around.
I love that the chatting, that we have such a great community in the live shows, and they all have gotten to know each other, and we have our Facebook groups that chat and share their projects, whatever they're working on. Cinnamon and I have a group called Angeluni on Facebook, which is kind of a joint group where you can kind of just share anything and everything that you're working on. And then I have a group called Thankful Art on Facebook as well, where people can share kind of what they've been doing in my projects and other things, original art and things. So it's been really fun. I started the group in November, I think, and it has just kind of become a thing. It's really amazing.
Yeah.
I feel bad if I miss a day, because then people have posted something that I didn't want to miss. One of my best friend's moms posted a picture that she had done of the ice cream cones on Monday, and I didn't see it until later on Tuesday. I felt really bad.
I think she'll forgive you for that.
Oh, for sure. I know. But I just kind of like, I don't want to diss my best friend's mom. It's kind of rude. Okay, I don't know why I'm doing that. It didn't need to be done. I'm just thinking and drawing. See, this is what can happen. You get into that zen state of mind, and you just kind of bliss out and kind of have fun with it.
Your body just does your thing, yeah.
What?
Your body just does its own thing while you're just talking.
That's right. Well, your mind kind of checks out, and you can just kind of, you know, get into it and do, you know, all kinds of fun things. So I'm going to switch over and show you how you can figure out how to do your little patterns here. I'm sure. I'm going to switch over to the one that I already started and do some coloring. Coloring is the most fun anyways. So these are my colored pencils. I want to show you how you can layer your colored pencils with your watercolor too. So I can lay down, say I want purple in the centers of these ones. I'm going to color those in with my colored pencil. And then when I watercolor over them, they're not going to spread. I don't have to be really careful about staying in the lines. I'll go ahead and do another one. Let's do a light blue right here. I love this dot inside of a dot thing. There's your eyeball, Spencer. Not really. Is Cashmere with you today?
Yeah, she's. I got her in bed right next to me. She's just.
Oh.
Helping me out.
Our kitty. Yeah. Our kitty cat has really enjoyed having Spencer out in her little part of the hallway there.
Yeah.
We had to put Spencer outside my studio. He's in a.
Yep.
We've rednecked it today.
Yep.
He's just outside my studio door because when we tested it, his mic was showing up on my.
It would echo.
Yeah, it was echoing.
Yeah,
so
she had to move me on the hallway. So.
Yeah, I put him out where he belongs.
Okay. Yeah. Yeah. Okay. Let's
see how it is. You see how it is? Okay.
Yes.
Not.
Cashmere's just staring at me. She's weird like that. I'll be eating something, and then I'll look over to my side, and she's just staring at me. She just will not stop looking at me.
She is a little bit of a creeper. Not even just a little bit, a lot of a creeper.
Yeah.
Okay, so I'm going to start some watercolors. I've got a little mini watercolor set here, and you can use whatever sets you've got. Even just like your regular old Crayola set will work just fine. excuse me. See, this is a... Okay, that's a little bit darker blue. Losing my voice today. Here's my pink. So I'm going to make myself a purple. With the pink and the blue, or the, this is kind of a magenta color here, it's kind of a dark red. I'm going to mix it with my blue. I checked the two blues, and I'm using the more purpley of the blues. So it's probably like a ultramarine blue or something like that that I'm using here. Let me add a little bit more of the blue. There we go. That's the color I want, and now I'm going to fill in my little Zentangle sections with this. If you pre-wet your sections, the paint will spread a little bit better for you, so you can go through and just kind of pre-paint some of those areas with water, and then when you set your color in there, they'll just spread around. Just make sure that you keep your water in the areas that you want it to, and you don't get it too wet. If you get it too wet, you can take a little towel and just kind of dab it off. Probably pick up a little bit of your color, but you can put that back in there. Or you can take a brush and just wipe your brush off and carefully set your brush down and lift off a little bit of the color if it gets too thick in any areas. Now if I go back over my other colors, they see the wax and the color pencil will resist my watercolor. It'll resist the water in my watercolor, so I can paint right over it, and it kind of fills in all those little cracks where the white is, and it'll change the color too a little bit. See how it changed that blue to a little bit of a lighter violet color, and it's making the in-between sections a little bit more pink. I'm just gonna go a little bit quicker and draw some water all the way across this whole section. When you're working with watercolors, you want to make sure that you work in between your sections. So I'm going to work on this section, then I'll skip this section and work on this section, and then skip this section and work on this section. So do every other section with your watercolors, and then go back once they're dry and do your, these two sections are dry, so that's why I can do this section here in between. If you were to do your sections right next to each other while they were wet, your colors would all bleed into one another. So it might be handy to have a little bit of a hairdryer or something in case you need to dry your sections. But there's enough sections here that I could go clockwise all the way around my thing, and by the time I got back down to my start point, I would be ready to do my other colors. So, and you can do whatever colors you want. The colors that I used in the middle of the peacock feather there. Let me go ahead and do that. If you don't have this yellow ochre color, which I have right here, you can mix something similar to it by using your yellow and just pull a little bit and put it on your palette somewhere. If you don't have a little palette section on your, most watercolor sets come with a little palette section, or you can use a foam plate or something like that if you need a little bit more area to work with. So clean that out, and then I'm going to pick up a little bit of brown, just a little bit, and put that in there with that. See what that does. See if I can get a color close to that first one. It's pretty close. Oops.
What happened?
I just picked it up and it went everywhere.
Oh,
that's hilarious.
So everything
my little going. Watercolor set like exploded. It exploded like that game. What was that game that we used to play?
Oh, I know what you're talking about. The one with like
perfection. Yes. Like all the little squares, and it would tick, tick, tick,
yeah,
tick,
yeah, yeah.
tick, and then it would like,
And then
everything
everything would
would
go flying around, yeah.
go flying. That's what just happened. Okay. I don't know if I can even get those back in there. I'll work on that later. I'm not exactly sure how that happened, but anyhow, I was going to show you how that color was close to the other one. Okay, you get the
point.
So
that part, just skip that part of the paint.
Don't. I wouldn't recommend doing that.
It takes a couple years of training to do.
Exactly.
I wouldn't expect anybody to get on the first try, but...
takes a lot of skill to get it just right. If I had done it better, I would have done all of them.
Oh, yeah, yeah.
But I only got the bottom half.
You're still learning that one.
I'm still learning. Yeah. Whoops. Got out some of the line there.
Still not much going on in chat. We're at 19 viewers right now.
Okay. Great. All right, I'm going to go here while this is wet, and I'm going to get clean water. Let's see if I can pull off a little bit of that color. Sometimes you can, sometimes you can't. It depends on the paper you're using, whether it's super absorbent. I'm just going to dab it off. Okay, so you get the idea. That's that color. Then for the eye part, I used a brighter green, kind of a turquoisey green. And then if you've got more of a yellow green, use that with some of your yellow. Just make sure when you're mixing it that you don't get your yellow too much green in your yellow. So go ahead and wet this down first, and that way you won't have a worry about your lines merging. I'm just doing this really fast just to kind of show you some of the colors to use. Now you could watercolor it first and then do your Zentangle patterns over the top if you want to. You can do it either way. It's just up to you. I like to do the Zentangle pattern first, and that way when I do my coloring, I can fill it in with special colors inside the patterns that I've made. And then this one is going to be a little bit of purple for the eye. So it's going to be more blue than red when you make your purple color. A really dark purple there. That's your basic colors for your peacock feather. If you want to, you can do yours differently. Let me show you how the watercolor pencils work. If you've never used one of these are awesome. I'm going to work on a zigzag right here. I'm going to color in just like my colored pencil, but this time when I water it down, it will activate the color in the pencil. It mostly stays where you put it, but it will spread a little bit. So what I would do if I'm doing two colors is I would color just the one color first, then wet it down, then do my second color after it's dry. That way you won't worry about it bleeding
out. Joanne Ford asks, are those Winsor or Newton Cotman brand watercolors?
These are the Winsor Newton Cotman little pocket set that I had. And I take this when I go traveling. It's a great little set. I also have the Crayola ones, but when I was looking at them yesterday, I have bigger sets of watercolors too, but this one's just easier to get on camera. So I went ahead and decided to use it. But it's great, and its colors are really vibrant, and it does a really good job. So I'm just going to carefully go over that area that I drew my color in on, and it just dissolves all of that pigment and makes it into a watercolor. It's really, really cool. It's great for kids because then they can control it a little bit better. And the colors get a little bit brighter, I feel like, with the colored watercolor pencils than with painting watercolors. And that way they don't have to mix their colors or do anything. You've got a whole number of colors that can come in a set, and they can just pick the one that they like and go, and they don't have to, you don't have to worry about them mixing any colors or anything like that. I really love the Inktense brand, the Derwent Inktense. Those are probably my favorites, but the Faber-Castell ones are good too. The Inktense pencils, grab one. Here, I'll use one and I'll show you the difference between these two. This one that I'm using today right here is one of the Low Cornell. And I really like it. It's got a really nice vibrant color. Okay, so I'm going to let that dry, and I'll come back to it. But I don't want to do my second color while that's wet. So let's do a little bit of, let me pick a better color. Let's pick a pink. Let's do some circles in this with the pink. And you could even get fancy with this, and I'll show you here on this one. I'll get a little fancier. I'll color it in with this color, and then I'll pick a darker pink or red. Let's go ahead and grab that red, and I'm going to color one side of it with the watercolor pencil so that it's shaded on one side. Now when we add our water to it, oops, my water's getting a little bit blue. See how that one side is a little bit darker than the other side where I did my shading.
There's still not a lot going on in the chat right now. We're at 22 people watching, though.
So awesome. That's good for a weekday. I'm happy with that.
Middle of the week, yeah.
Middle of the week. A lot of kids are still in school, but I wanted to get this out early so that they'd have it for later on in the summer. Okay, here's the Inktense ones, and these are a lot brighter, I feel like, than any of the other. Ooh, that one is dusky purple. Let's see what this does. I always tell the kids to go a lot lighter with this pencil than they think they need to, because this color will, some of the colors will almost turn black. They're so vibrant. That's the Inktense. And I guess they're not technically watercolors. They're actually ink. So that may be why that they're a little bit more vibrant. Okay, let's see what happens when we see how bright that color is. I mean, it's really dark. I'm just gonna fill that up. Okay. And just think about your color balance. You could do your color story where you did like a rainbow type of effect, where you started out with like all reds and then they went to yellows or oranges and then yellows and then greens all the way across and did something like that. That would be really cool. You could do every other. I'm doing kind of more of a balanced design where I have a little bit of purple here, so I'm putting a little bit of purple down here and a little bit more in here and kind of trying to balance out my color story. But you can get as creative as you want. The kids absolutely love this. I've done several Zentangles. This has been one of the most favorite ones that I've done with them. They really did a great job. And it's easy to draw.
Relatively.
And if you have a youngster who can't draw, you could draw it out for them ahead of time and then just give them some colors. They don't even have to use the watercolors. The watercolors are a little bit more difficult. So, you know, one might do the watercolor part with an older child. You could also do, let me show you, if you wanted to use a larger brush, you could fill in several sections with water all at one time. And I've done this with when we did our owl Zentangle, which I have that drawing. I'll post the link in my iCards. I have that drawing that I did last year. I didn't do the Zentangle with it, but what I did, I didn't do the Zentangle with it in my video, but when I did it with my kids, what I had them do is paint around the owl with the water, and then we took color and filled in so that the Zentangle part of the owl was white, and then all around it was this kind of blended watercolor. This paper does not do well with the watercolor. I would use watercolor paper for this because it will do the effect a lot better than this does. But see how it blends those colors together? So that's if you wet your paper beforehand, and you can do two colors that you know will blend well together and get this really cool effect. So you could do your whole background that way and then fill in your patterns if you wanted to. That would be another really cool way of doing it. Okay, I think I'm going to call it quits today. We did 40 minutes. That's really good. I hope you've enjoyed it today. If you do this project, I'd love to see it. You can share it with me on my Thankful Art page. And be sure to check back with me tomorrow, 12 noon, on my channel here. And I will be doing a butterfly mixed media project. The background here is paper, so if you don't want to use paint, you can do this on paper. I'll show you both ways. So hope you join me for that. Thank you so much for watching today. I'll see you next time.
Bye.
Bye.